What is the goriest thing you have seen in real life? Unfortunately, I was taking pictures of an abandoned factory for a high school project and I found a dog that was completely gutted, unwrapped in duct tape. I literally just stood there in shock for a few minutes while trying to process what I was seeing. I told my mother what I saw and she said it was probably a warning to someone, and that I shouldn't go back, and I never did. I also heard a man jump and land from the top of a building, 4 stories, he lived but was paralyzed. I didn't see it happen, only the aftermath, but I heard it. And like you, I'll never forget the sound. Another thing that haunts me, no one came to clean up the blood. He landed in front of my building door, so for a few days, until it rained, I would be reminded of what happened by a large stain on the asphalt. An infected mesh implant from the time of the Vietnam War comes to mind. A patient came in complaining of mild neuro symptoms and the surgeon did a craniotomy. PT had a prior bullet wound from his time in Vietnam and they had placed a mesh implant to protect him. It got infected but he didn't know about the infection for decades. All the staff got to see and smell what the mesh and surrounding tissue was like. I truly cannot describe the smell. There was nothing like it to me, ever. I'm a medical malpractice attorney, so I've seen some shit. Fasciotomy cases are wicked. Necrotizing fasciitis is brutal. A stump right after amputation with stitches everywhere. Infection following mastectomy where you can't even tell a breast ever existed because all you see is a festering wound. But the worst, I'd have to say, is bed sore cases, especially because so often it is elderly people that have them. Saw necrotic, black, oozing, giant holes in grandma and grandpa's genital areas. It's always pure gore. My grandma told me, she was a nurse, that once she had a bed sore client that had some kind of open wound. She was doing house visits as he couldn't be transported anymore. Anyways, it was summer during a heat wave. Guy wasn't feeling too well and called her. When she got the end wanted to clean his wound and took off the bandages, lower leg, she was immediately greeted with the most disgusting smell she ever experienced. Guy's whole leg from knee down was covered in maggots. Good thing, the maggots actually kept the wound clean and saved him from getting his leg amputated. I spoke to a taxi driver who used to work for the railway a few years ago. He was sent to pick me up because my train was cancelled halfway through the journey due to a suicide. He told me the worst he saw was the aftermath of a mother picking up her child to look at the approaching train, and the top half of the child got taken with the train as it passed. The mother was left holding onto the child's hip screaming. He quit after that and all of the workers and witnesses ended up needing therapy for it. I sometimes think of that poor mother when I see trains. Can't even imagine. I found a young girl, 19 young, who had fallen 6 stories to the concrete courtyard below. She landed feet first but still hit her head on the brick. She broke every bone from her toes to her hips and maybe a few more. When I found her, she had been there for up to an hour as I had been through that area an hour before. She had blood leaking from her nose and ears but she was still alive and somewhat alert as she was able to follow me with her gaze. She was taken to hospital by ambulance and I believe she survived but I don't know if she walked again. I have a similar one. I was walking in a city center and there was a pigeon on the road. Bus comes in, sees the pigeon, slow down to like 1 mph because the pigeon was not moving away. Bus driver proceeds slowly, assuming it's going to move eventually. It didn't. And to visualize the scene, imagine slowly pressing a toothpaste tube from the end, only with pink paste slowly getting out. There was a girl scout group witnessing the scene near me. I will never forget their screams, lol. Came up on a car accident many years ago. 2 cars hit offset at highway speeds. The engine of the smaller car, 90s Saturn coupe, was laying in the road. I went up to the Saturn first. The steering wheel was pushed up against his chest. Both of his legs were mangled and he had bone sticking out of his left leg just above the knee. He was breathing but barely, red foam coming out of his mouth and nose. I was on the phone with 911 when he stopped breathing. The guy in the other car was also badly injured. He was awake and talking but not making any sense at all. He had some bad cuts on his face and his left arm was almost completely severed. That dispatcher walked me through putting a tourniquet on his arm. I also took a coat out of my car to help keep him warm. It was extremely cold out, probably around negative 15°F. From what I later found out, that guy died later during the helicopter flight to the hospital. He was the sober one. I watched somebody get decapitated. They were speeding and doing a wheelie on a motorcycle and went headfirst into the trailer of a turning truck. Bike and body kept going forward. It was a high set trailer, head went upwards and backwards. Lots of blood. I called my boss to let him know what I'd witnessed. Someone else was calling the cops. He responded by telling me the best thing to do was to shake it off and focus on work. As a child, I saw a kid attempt to climb up a water slide as a little girl slid down. The kid's knee hit her mouth and she lost most of her teeth. I was young myself, but the bloody water coming down the slide, the girl's cries and the flowing hour me and my friends spent looking for her teeth in the splash pool is still very clear in my mind. Later I was told the majority of her teeth were fitted back into her mouth by a local dentist, but I was skeptical and thought this might be a white lie to make me feel better. If any dentists are able to confirm if this is possible, that would be appreciated. I was working doing drain cleaning when I was young. One day I got called out to a job on a small sewer main. I could see where the blockage was, so I went and pulled the manhole downstream up and a high-pressure self-propelled hose in and sent it upstream. I hit the blockage and water flowed to where I was, so I pulled the hose back and the water stopped flowing. I sent it up again and same thing. I had flow, pulled it back and it stopped again, so I walked up to the upstream manhole and lifted it. What I saw was a hessian bag and I could see a tuft of hair sticking out, short blonde hair. Earlier that day I was talking to a plumber who had a friend who, I have no idea why this came up in conversation, had found a baby in a manhole. So with that fresh in my mind and quite freaked out, I opened the bag to find a dog partly decomposed, enough that if you touched it the skin and hair would split and fall off. Who the fuck puts a dog, I hope dead, in a fucking manhole? ? And guess who had to deal with that shit? I found my dad dead. He'd probably been like that for about 3 days. Either heart attack or stroke. They didn't do an autopsy. It wasn't that bad. Smelled a little. My mom shot herself in the head about 20 feet from me. I had my back turned so I didn't see all of it. I got little glimpses as I called 911, and then once the police showed up to deal with it, there was matter left on the porch from where they carried her out. I'm really not sure if it was someone's puke or brain matter. I was treating a patient with a sublingual tumor. Basically, the cancer ate through the bottom of the mouth and her tongue would hang out the bottom and saliva would drop everywhere. Had to MacGyver a catchment device that was portable and as discreet as possible. Either that or watching another patient rip open her own abdominal stitches with her bare hands and proceeded to shove her arm a little over mid-forearm deep. Fairly big dog running alongside the retaining sound barrier wall on the freeway at about 8 p.m. It's pretty well lit, not many cars on the road at all. We could see he had tags on and pulled over on the shoulder a little past him, and I got out, wanting to call the dog over to us to get him to safety. He was probably a good 300 feet from the actual road and started trotting towards our car like he was going to come to us. He got maybe 50 feet from me, stopped, and for whatever reason bolted towards the carpool lane into traffic. It took about 30 seconds for someone in an F-250 to hit him at probably 75 miles per hour. The dog exploded and I lost it. Thankfully the driver stopped and pulled over, but there really wasn't much need to at that point. We shakily called CHP and drove home, hugged my dog extra hard when we got in. Man, these comments are some of the most ignorant toxic ones on here. If you don't like hunting, so be it. But hunting is the primary source of funding for natural resource preservation in many countries. In the US, hunting is the primary tool used for population control of species, keeping terrible diseases and overpopulation issues from decimating regions. Nobody said this guy was hunting bears. All of you celebrating a man's gruesome death should be ashamed of yourselves. Three things all from the restaurant industry. Co-worker was changing the fryer oil, slipped when carrying the old hat oil out to the disposal and dumped it all over himself. Saw another co-worker's arm get stuck in a pizza rolling machine. He gloved his entire arm up to his elbow. Saw someone's hand get wrapped around the dull corkscrew on commercial stand mixer. Snapped the bones in his arm like toothpicks. I think he ended up losing the arm. Kitchen work ain't no joke. I was EMT for many years. Saw the same. More memorable gore included a beheading in a motor vehicle accident. Attending to a woman who committed suicide using a .357 revolver in her mouth. The cops were the first ones to arrive and proceeded to begin CPR, and thus we continued care until we could get a pronouncement via radio from the ER doc after explaining that the entire back of the patient's skull had lost its integrity and the cranial organ was largely displaced and severely fragmented. Also, was on the scene of a murder-suicide where the mother killed her husband and one of her children, while her two older ones were at school, before killing herself. Oh, and just because it's obligatory for a Reddit post, a penis mutilation. I went on the exact slide about 3 days before that little boy did. The line for it was huge, and they weighed everyone in your group on a big scale before getting on. They mixed and matched your party to make the raft you got and have the correct amount of weight to not allow it to come too far off the slide. To explain clearer, if you showed up with three friends that were all thin and light, they might swap one or two of your friends out for a bigger person from the line until your total raft weight was heavy enough to keep the raft down. I don't know if one of the teenage minimum wage employees got the weight wrong and the whole raft came up, or if the kid was just too light himself and wasn't strapped in to stay down, or if the Velcro straps failed. I don't think it was an employee's fault though. They showed clips of the dummies they used for the test drives of the ride being thrown off and decapitated just days before opening it, but they opened it anyway because they wanted the title of tallest water slide in the world or something, and wanted it open for the season. So, there was a portion of the ride without mesh at the top, and a portion with mesh. He was high enough out of his seat in the open air part for his neck to meet right where the mesh started up again, and it decapitated him. He must have come out of the restraints. My blood ran cold when I heard about that. I had just ridden that ride. They kept showing the blood streaking from the water slide on the news, with an overlay of that little boy's baseball portrait. Horrifying. There was a billboard for that water park advertising for that specific ride along the highway that they had to scramble to take down immediately. It was haunting to drive past after the incident. Edit. The name of the slide was Verrückt, which I think means crazy in German. Yup, it certainly was crazy to open that to the public when tests were destroying crash dummies. Irresponsible. I hope the family got money. Me and my friends were little shits growing up, finding abandoned homes to party in. Someone mentioned a place that was ripe. We break in, no electricity. Start to set up smoking material when someone complains about the smell. This was before mobile phones, so there was little to no light. Found a bloated dead body, fused into the sofa and running alive with maggots. It was horrific. Left, was sick and phoned the police. I was given a little like lunch cooler by an emergency room surgeon and told to go retrieve my cousin's severed thumb from the chop saw he cut it off with. So I did. Yes, I put it in the correct packaging scent, put it in that cooler, rushed it back to the ER. It was all for nothing. We now call him Stumpy. It looked like a fake rubber finger but felt cold and leathery. Worked at a veterinary clinic in San Antonio. Someone brought a dog in to be put to sleep. I was a kennel assistant, so I had to be around to clean up afterward. This dog, a Doberman, had been shot in the head and had parvovirus. The hillbilly owner had tried to kill the dog but it didn't work, so he brought the poor thing into the clinic. Shot in the damn head, still alive and having diarrhea. There was blood and shit on the exam table and floor. It was horrifying. I almost quit that job on the spot. Edit. The smell of parvo itself is terrible. It's like death warmed over for a year mixed with shit, vomit, and maggots. It's nothing you want to ever experience. I was driving one of the 5-ton work trucks pulling a large wood chipper close to 3,000 pounds when a guy on a moped scooter thing came into my lane and hit the chipper going the opposite direction. He hit the chipper so hard it blew open a diamond plate aluminum box on the side and unbeaded the tire from the rim. He didn't die instantly. His shoes blew off, his helmet blew off. I have never seen and hopefully never will again see a person that mangled. This was just 7 days after my son was born at home. In just a week I saw a life come into this world and one go out. My twin sister died from sepsis last year. Both me and her have severe autoimmune diseases, and hers was severe whole colon ulcerative colitis. She had an ulcer that perforated her colon and leaked toxins into her bloodstream, and she got severely septic. The reason she died was medical malpractice. The doctor refused to keep her at the hospital. This was when COVID was huge, and she went home and they found her dead in bed at night and screamed for my mother and brother. She was my bestest friend in the whole world. She was the only person that's ever truly loved and accepted me for who I was. We were inseparable and eternally bonded. She's in the spirit world now, but the thing I'll never forget is when the ambulance took her and she spent 3 days with her organs shutting down and her brain dying. I went in there to visit one last time. I cut a lock of her hair and it's still at my abusive narcissist mother's house in Florida. I'll never forget visiting her and seeing her on that ventilator, eyes open but unmoving. But when I told her she'd be passing away, she cried. She actually had tears come out on the ventilator, and that worried expression and a slight shaking of her head. So she was still there. But when my mom came back to take her off life support, she was gone all the way. Because we didn't have the money, she was cremated, and that wasn't what she wanted. Both of us twins wanted a burial for each twin. And because she died that year, one attempted suicide 6 months ago, because I couldn't live without her. I was saved and now I'm mostly happy, but sometimes I still wanna join her. Especially when shit gets hard and I'm very different and unique and it's extremely hard for me to make friends. So it's the loneliness that gets to me, and sometimes it drives me to feeling suicidal still. I can't much ever speak of her death anymore because the huge overwhelming amount of PTSD will come out and I'll be a heaping crying sobbing mess. So I have three experiences. The first one, a trainee jumped on a piece of equipment without permission, and when he thought he would get caught, he jumped off and got pinned between the equipment and a wall and got hurt bad. The second tried to stop a roll of sheet metal with his footer and destroyed his leg. The third, we were working a rail car and the bulkhead broke loose and got crushed to death by a bulkhead. The sound of your coworker getting crushed to death is unforgettable. It started with an oh fuck and turned into a scream of desperation as the bulkhead fell on top of him. I can't articulate everything well, but when you are there in that moment and you watch your friend die by being crushed, hearing them scream for help as you are helpless to do anything, it stays with you. The guilt is heavy. I'll never forget the sound of him being crushed and watching as his insides being pushed up from his feet out through his head, while you hear the sound of his breath being pushed out of his body as his insides. Anyway, I watched my coworker get rolled like a tube of toothpaste and saw him turn inside out. One out of 10, I don't recommend. Brother, I still miss you every day. I'm sorry I couldn't help. Robert Beltran, you are missed. Not seen, but felt. Many moons ago, I was doing my trauma rotation in nursing school. One of the big local businesses was a crane factory. A worker fell 20-something feet, landing on his back. My let the student do something relatively harmless task was to stabilize his cervical spine by holding his head in my hands when he has rolled around for the trauma assessment. As I was cradling his head, I realized it felt like a cracked, soft-boiled egg. All the little fragments of crushed skull just mushed around in my hand like pieces of eggshell in a fleshy sack of goo. 20 years on, I've seen plenty of visually disturbing gore, but that's one of the few tactile memories that actually gives me a bit of the jibblies. In college, we had rented the indoor hall. We had a 200 meters track for scale to have a mixed scrimmage with our male Ultimate Team and the female Ultimate Team on some Sunday. In the central area, the space was set up so you could put up tennis nets and volleyball nets. Right when we were about to start, some woman from the community came up in a fuss about us being there, saying we needed to leave. We went over the booking sheet with her to show we had the place, but said that if she wanted to take the last tennis court space out of the way at the end, that we would be okay with that. Maybe 20 minutes in, a teammate uncorks a big throw all the way to the end zone, and I see my teammate booking it to catch it, and all I can do is kind of stop and stare in some sort of shock as I see him jump for the disc, and then very clearly get caught on something right around his crotch and kind of cartwheel around the post. Having been trained in first aid, I immediately ran up to him and did the general checks. A friend who was almost done with her nursing degree was right behind me with some towels. She checks his leg over and I start holding pressure on the wound while waiting for the paramedics. 5 minutes later, the paramedic comes walking into the hall, right as my teammate says to me, while the color drained from his face, "You know, I think I'm okay. It doesn't even hurt anymore." At this point, I'm well out of my training and comfort zone, so I urge the paramedic over. We had stopped the bleeding for the time being, but the paramedic needs to see the damage, so right in front of me pulls back the towels, which at this point had been congealed to the skin, and for the first time in my life saw the inside of someone's leg, which was both shocking and intriguing.